be your moderator today. What does that mean? Really not much. I'm just going to try and keep this train on the tracks and on a timely schedule. We're scheduled to go for an hour. What is the legislative forum? It gives you, well, first of all, thank you to the chamber for putting this on. Chamber does a great job every year putting on multiple legislative forums, which give you an opportunity to hear from your legislative body and representatives on what's been going on in Frankfort and what may happen the rest of the session. Logistics, for those folks that may not know, we have coffee and water to my right and to your left. If you need to use the restroom, there are two double doors to, again, to my right, to your left, and there's a hallway, and the restroom's right out there. I know we've already received a bunch of questions, but for those folks that may not know, there should be some note cards on your chairs. If you feel like you want to ask a question, please write it down, pass it to your left, and we'll try to pick them up, and we'll try to get through as many questions as possible. Well, since we only have a short amount of time, let's get this thing started. Joe, I'm going to start with you, and then Suzanne, I'm going to go to you, since you got the most seniority in the house. So it's going to be the same question, okay? No, never. I would never say that about you. Me, yes, but you, no. We had a very busy start to this legislative session, even before we had our first legislative forum. Could you please, or for Joe specifically, congrats on Senate Bill 2, but could you please give us an update and describe the efforts and results since we last met, and what are the Senate's blue chips for the remaining part of the session?
Yeah, well, thank you, and boy, it's great to see so many people here this morning. I really didn't know what to anticipate in the way of a crowd this morning, so it's great. It's great to see you all, and I think it's kind of reflective of the crowds that we've seen in Frankfort. We've had a lot of visitors from Owensboro, so it's been busy up there. Senate Bill 2, that's, of course, obviously, that is a bill that's very important to me. I sponsored that bill, and simply what it does, it provides transparency in our pension systems, much needed. And I could spend the whole hour talking about pensions. I could spend the next day talking about how we got to where we are and what the path looks like going forward. If I had a blackboard, it would be helpful to explain the flow chart of how the pension organization is set up and what got us to this point of the funding levels that we're currently at. But Senate Bill 2 is a bill that provides us the opportunity to look inside of the systems and actually see what's going on. See the makeup of the board, see the investments that are involved, see what the fees are involved with the investments, see who the investments are with, see if there is actually a best practices approach to the way we invest our money. So it's just a total look inside of the system. Now the beauty of this bill, if it's one-sided, it is not. I spent the entire interim engaging in conversations with the folks at KRS, the folks at TRS, the folks in the judiciary retirement system, every retirement system that we have, and we have eight, and with those eight, we have a corresponding health benefit plan. I spent all summer and fall talking to these people, engaging them in helping me craft a piece of legislation that that adequately addressed the needs that we have in helping you folks that are dependent upon a pension. Those of you that have worked in the Kentucky in the education field or a state employee or whatever, this gives us the opportunity. Senate Bill 2 gives the legislature the opportunity to be proactive as opposed to reactive. We've never had any tools at our disposal. All we could do is react to bad news, and this puts us in a better position. Now we have the opportunity to do some things going forward that we quite frankly didn't have before. I don't want to take a lot of time, Mark, but again, I'd love to have a session someday where that's all we talked about and had a blackboard, and I could show you how this thing's all unraveled. I may not be part of the solution. Who knows what's down the road, but I can promise you one thing. Myself and a few others have identified what the problem is.
Thanks, Joe. Suzanne?
Well, it has been busy. I want to recognize Steve Loyal. I know he's been a staple to the chamber and the legislative world, and we've missed you. So welcome back. Glad to see you. We've had, like you said, we have had a lot of visitors. We have been working quite late. I guess Monday night it was after 11 before we left session. I don't know how familiar you all are with how bills pass, but whenever we go to committees, if we pass them out of consent, that means everyone on the committee agreed that this was good legislation and voted for it, put it on the consent calendar. And we've got some people that are not friendly right now to the majority party that went and pulled everything off the consent calendar. So we voted through all of those and stayed until after 11 to get our work done. So I've had 3 bills passed this week sent to the House, one specifically addressed with dealerships, that just a modernization bill. Another one was metal commodities. To include, we can transport steel right now 150 miles with an overweight permit, and now we don't have that.
That doesn't do it. That goes directly into the camera.
So,
I just need to talk louder, right?
Yeah.
There's
okay.
A microphone up there.
I'll just talk louder. That's fine.
Standing up helps too.
Excuse me?
Standing up helps too. Protect your voice.
Yeah. Well, I'll just talk louder. Can you hear me better now? Okay. Metal commodity bill, that will actually help a lot of our industries in this area, not only the smelters, but also our recycles. Right now, we've got recycles up here on E60. If they want to go over the bridge and hit Indiana, it just kind of sticks them in a bad way because they're illegal, that section, until they hit the Maceo Bridge, if they want to do that. Same way in Henderson. Whenever they leave Henderson, you know, they've got a short stretch of mileage till they hit Indiana. It doesn't make them competitive. So we've got a lot of bills that we're looking at to kind of raise the parity, to just kind of make things a little bit easier for Kentucky to be competitive on things like that. Another bill I had passed just yesterday, it was originally on consent, pulled off consent, was an agritourism bill. And that is helpful for specifically our barns that people want to use.
Can you repeat that? We can't hear. Sorry, I couldn't hear the last one.
Agritourism bill, and it is very specific for our agritourism industry, the ones that have like the barns that they want to use for weddings and things like that. So we've got some issues that we're working on, things like on those items. As far as the big items that have passed the House this past week have been medical review panels, which I know Steve Johnson in the back is doing a little dance and jumping up and down. We desperately have needed some type of check and balance for whenever there's accusations made. And just kind of give a synopsis of, we had someone that was really fighting hard against medical review panels, and she gave the illustration that she went to the emergency room, she was waiting, and her boyfriend went up and threatened basically the people at the emergency room, if they didn't hurry up and get her back, that her family, she was a lawyer, he was a lawyer, and they would sue and just own that hospital if they didn't hurry up and treat her. Well, she was saying everyone ought to have the right to sue. Well, that's the fear right now whenever people go and they do those things like that. You know, whenever we go to the emergency room, we're at their mercy to help us, and we've asked them to help us. If they have that fear every time you walk in the door that they're going to be sued, they have to do everything to make sure that they don't cross any lines to help that person. So it's amazing the difference in opinion. You know, she was saying we can't have medical review panels because that takes away your ability to sue. It does not take your ability away to sue, but it does at least put some balance in there that you can't just threaten nonstop without, you know, the frivolous lawsuit. So we're hoping that that kind of helps out a little bit on that. Yesterday, there was a debate, I guess, on the House floor, is it 3 hours?
Yes.
On charter schools. Well, charter schools are coming to Kentucky. We're one of the few that don't have them. And when we say charter school, that doesn't mean that it's just a private school that we only cherry pick the best and the brightest. Charter schools is an opportunity for public educators, the public school system even, to have some opportunities to teach children in a different manner. We've got the Innovation Academy here in Owensboro. Any of you all that have seen that have seen what a phenomenal job they're doing. And I commend our locals for creating that.
We are going to have any public discussion. They'll be here afterwards if you want to talk to them, but this is a question. We give them the questions and then they talk, okay?
Well, I think we should be allowed to have a opinion in the paper.
And so those are some of the items that have taken place this past week, and we've been extremely busy. I know these fellows are the same way I work as far as what time we left last night to be back in town. So we've literally been back in Owensboro for less than 10 hours. I'll turn it over to Matt and let him talk.
If I can, because I know I've got something that you want to talk about, Matt. So I'm going to tee up this next topic because Suzanne's already gotten to it, and then we'll just go down the line if that's okay.
Sure.
There have been many questions submitted today in relation to charter schools.
We cannot hear. We can't hear you.
I'm sorry.
But the microphone's not working.
Right here. Just let somebody come up from the back and sit here.
Does the microphone work?
There's two seats up here.
They're just for the cameras.
Oh, those are just for the cameras.
They should stand up.
Yeah, just pick up.
I'll be glad to, because I'm surprised. It's the first time someone's told me they couldn't hear me. There have been many questions asked related to charter schools. Can you give us a recap on the legislation, the debate thus far, and what kind of public input you had from your constituents here? Joe, you want to start?
Sure. We just got the bill. It just passed out of the Senate yesterday. I literally read the bill for the first time this morning at about 5 o'clock in the morning. Because until a bill gets over on our side, I have so many bills that I have to deal with. It's a moot point until it passes out of the House and comes to the Senate. So at 5 o'clock this morning, I read that bill in its entirety. And so I'm making my decision right now on charter schools. Let me say this though. The arguments that I've heard, the people that I've engaged outside of this community and the people that are going to be impacted the most by charter schools. There was an African-American minister from West Jefferson County that said, this is the Civil Rights Act of this time. The charter schools is in fact the Civil Rights Act of this decade because children are being denied in certain areas of the state. The original charter bill was going to be a pilot program in Jefferson County and Fayette County. I like that concept, but it's changed. The bill that was brought forward by an educator, a former educator, the bill that we have in front of us now. So, you know what, for the decision-making process for me is fluid right now. I'm looking at it, I'm studying it. And there are obviously benefits, and there are those that say there are that it's detrimental in other ways. So I'll have to come to a conclusion on that. We'll vet it out. I'll listen to all the testimony, but I've been through the bill very thoroughly. Let me just say this. I look at everything because I'm kind of been brainwashed through the prism of pensions. Everything that I look at, how's it going to affect our pension system? I will tell you, it will help the payroll growth of the TRS system. So if you're concerned about that, at least that's one benefit for those of you that are in the education world.
Thanks, Joe. Suzanne?
I'm going to go ahead. I've already brought it up. I'm going to let you get your opinion.
Well, I'm going to kind of give you my opinion of it. And I was very transparent shortly right after the election about charter schools. And there were so many different versions of charter schools that were floating around out there. I'm a Davis County High School graduate, and I'm the only representative probably on the floor that is a high school graduate that doesn't have a college education. And so I'm a product of public schools. But I also have two children, a three-year-old and a six-year-old, and my six-year-old attends Eastview Elementary School. So when I started looking into charter schools and I met with Dr. Brake and so many other ones, we are blessed in our community to have great public schools. But we cannot hold that over to those who do not have that opportunity in Kentucky. You know, we're all in this together, and it should be about the students. It should never be about taking the money away from our public schools. It should be about making sure that our students have the best options possible to receive an education. These are still public schools. Basically, what it does, if you know, we talk about our classrooms and so many things being overcrowded and things like this. This just creates more locations in the state of Kentucky for those to receive education. And the parents of these children that are going there pay the same exact taxes that we pay for school systems. So when I looked at the system, I tried to look at it from both sides. As someone who attended a public school, as someone who sends my kids to public schools, of saying, how can I deny a student in Jefferson County or other places in the state that don't have great school systems like we have here in Davis, Ohio, Hancock County, and surrounding areas? So when I looked into this legislation, I voted yes in favor of this matter to help the students of Kentucky.
I just, not a lot to add to that, but I'll say this, a reminder, a charter school is still in the public school system. It's not a private school. It's in the same process. So we're not taking money from the public school system. We're keeping it in the public school system. What we're doing is just thinking outside the box a little bit so that our children will have a better chance to get ahead. And again, same thing Matt said, we are so blessed in this community with the school systems that we have, with the leadership that we have. They think outside the box, they're creative, they look for the opportunities for the children. It is not like that across the state. There are places in this state that need help. And when that's what we're trying to do. And I'll just add one other thing. Charter schools are not all of a sudden going to start popping up all over the state, because the process of getting the authority and putting one in place is intentionally tedious and detailed and difficult. And it should be that way, because if we're going to do something like that, it needs to be a slow process so that everything is done properly. So they're just not going to pop up all over the place. But there are schools, systems in this state where children are just, they're literally being tortured with having to go through what they're going through. And we can make a difference with that. And I don't think it's going to affect us here because of the great system we have. But we owe it to the other kids in this state to help them out if we possibly can. We've got to be creative. We've got to help them.
And going back to the actual authorizers of this are the local school boards. And so, you know, the end result, if there's an appeals process, that would go another way. But the reality is, it's going to be at the local level that that conversation takes place and are the local authorizers. The only place that that would be different would be Louisville and Lexington. And that, quite honestly, is where our biggest problems in this state. I mean, they kept quoting yesterday, as far as high school students that graduate out of Louisville, 56% cannot read at grade level. So we're graduating 56% that can't read at grade level. That's really scary. And then the math numbers were even less than that, as far as being able to do math. I mean, that just breaks my heart, because I would put up any of our school systems here locally up against anyone, you know, globally for that matter. But the reality is that we have areas in our state that don't have schools like we have, that don't have teachers like Mr. Westerfield, like I had in public school. And so, you know, if not everyone can have that, we need to give that option to our kids. We really have to give some opportunities out there. And we've got to think differently. If we're not moving forward in education, if we stay exactly the same place, you know, what are we doing?
I just had one other thing unaffected while they're getting ready to tee up the next one. Those schools that she just mentioned that had literacy rates of 50% or less, those were considered by whatever the national evaluation system is as excellent schools. I don't remember the exact term, but they were like considered top schools. It's not the teachers or the principals or any of that that's broken. It's the system. How can a national evaluation say that schools where the students, half of them can't read at grade level, is an excellent school? We have got to start thinking differently about these issues. And that's all this is about. And I was pleased. It was a tough vote in some ways. But at the same time, if we can do something for the students, that's the way I'm going to vote. And people don't like me, it's okay, but I'm going to vote for the students.
The authorizer will be the local districts, the local boards of education. So that will be the authorizer. So you folks will be part of the process. I mean, you know, you can give your input to our local school board members. They're accessible. Give them your opinion, because that's who's going to authorize the charters, which is a pretty fair method. But I can tell you, like has been alluded to previously, there are some systems. This is being driven primarily by some failing systems in other parts of the state. And the likelihood of a charter being in Davis County, those odds are probably pretty long, particularly when I saw the superintendent of the Davis County Public Schools come out against it. So, you know, for our area, it may be much to do about nothing, because we do have excellent public schools here. But that's not the case. Again, I'll reiterate, that's simply not the case across the rest of the Commonwealth.
Thanks, sir.
I want to make one more point, too, and I talked to Dr. Breck about this a little bit. You know, the reason we have great public schools in our area is because we have great teachers and great faculty. You know, the school
and
system
parents.
And parents, supportive parents. You know, and that's what it takes to make it work. I mean, you know, there has to be a sense of value when you go into these school systems and you start teaching these kids. There's other places in the state of Kentucky that I have witnessed, that I have talked to other representatives who represent that area, that are not as blessed as we are. And so I know it's tough for some, but, you know, it is not about just the teachers or just this. It's about taking care of the students. And you all are doing a great job in our community doing that for the students. But we have to also take and stand up for all the students in Kentucky, because this is our future. And this is a future generation that will be running the country and that will be, you know, working at the plants and so many other things.
Thank you. Joe, you had mentioned a little bit ago I'm going to direct this question to you. Are pensions for the legislators included in Senate Bill 2?
Yeah, all the systems are included in Senate Bill 2. Sure, certainly. Absolutely.
Thank you. Switching to transportation. I-65 spur work and Highway 54 widening remain at the top of our priority list. Can you give us an update on those projects?
It's all about federal money right now. The state funds for new construction is not there. There's money for maintenance, but new construction, the highway trust fund just does not have money available for new construction. So that's a fact of the matter. So what we focused on doing is these important projects that we've got, and all of us have, it's been a collaborative effort, and it's been a collaborative effort with the transportation cabinet and with our delegation in Washington, D.C. So we've tried to re-identify these projects as federal projects as opposed to state projects. And that's the route we're going to have to go. Certainly, that's what's going to happen with the I-65 spur, the Natcher Parkway. And now we're trying to do the same thing with the 54 expansion. But that's what we're forced to do. Right now, it's the only place money is available for new projects.
Suzanne, would you mind giving us an update on House Bill 184?
What is 184? I'm sorry, aluminum hauling bill. It passed the House. What it does, it raises the weight from, and it's a special permit for an overweight, from raising it from 80,000 to 120. It is based upon 20 per axle. That also, I know Matt can get more detail on the specifics on the safety side of it, but it passed the House, has moved to the Senate. Hopefully it'll be heard in Senate Transportation this next week. And it's just really a big economic driver. Economic development, the State Economic Development Cabinet has come out in support of it, the State Transportation. This is a top priority of the governor also, that we make sure that we open the doors for business in the state of Kentucky. And this is one of the many items that we have that will help our state of Kentucky be a level playing field. Indiana, Ohio, Michigan, all of these have, and it is a special permit. They do have to be permitted. They do have to go on a specific route. And sometimes people kind of forget, and we had the debate on the floor, sometimes people forget how consumers get their goods. You know, everyone might not like to see a semi-truck on the road. They might not like to see a barge floating down the river. They might not like to see a lot of the different things that take place in the state of Kentucky. But the reality is consumer goods are driven by transportation. And if we don't give the, you know, if we don't make a level playing field for our state of Kentucky to transport goods, then we're being left out of the equation. And so that's specifically what House Bill 184 is to address, is the overweight permits for metal commodities. And that would include, as of right now, we have steel that's at 150 miles that can be permitted. But as far as the, we don't have it for the metal commodities. So that's what the bill is about. And these fellows have been co-sponsors onto it, so they can also answer any questions on that one too. But it's to level the playing field. We've got a lot of things that we need to level the playing field in the state of Kentucky. And that will be any additional permits that go along with that, any permits that you get for those, all that money goes into the road fund. So that's just kind of long or the short of that one.
I'll make a few more comments on it too. You know, this is just another simple piece of legislation that bridges a gap that we had. You know, it doesn't completely change how the law is written, or it doesn't change the ground bearing pressure on the roads or anything, because so many people have had concerns that these overweight trucks are going to be hard on our highways and stuff like this. Well, when you read the bill, it talks about 700 pounds low bearing pressure per square inch. We didn't ask to change it. We didn't ask to change it to 800, 900 to 1,000. Simply, all we have done is had it where when they haul 120,000 pounds, they add more axles. When you add more axles, you add more brake drums. You know, it's no different than a woman walking across the grass in a high heel versus a snowshoe. You know, you're going to spread the same amount of weight out on a bigger footprint. And so, you know, these are one of those things that helps make it more. And, well, it is.
Different analogy. And, I don't know.
It's one of these bills too that you know, it's one of the largest and one of the fastest growing industries coming now. I mean, there's some you know, the high alloy lightweight aluminum is going to be a metal that's used in our automotive industry. It's going to be used in so many things, and this technology is growing so fast, and it's here in Kentucky. Some of the last smelters and some of the last aluminum producing stuff is right here in Kentucky. You know, we talk about wanting to see job growth and we want to see an economic boost for our state. You know, that's 18,000 people working in the aluminum industry in the state of Kentucky alone. You know, so this is something here that's going to allow them to stay competitive. And we got to remember, too, that we compete on an international level now. It's not just about Kentucky. It's about Kentucky against China and against so many other places. So all these kind of things here help bridge the gap to make us a more competitive marketplace.
I'll just give one quick analogy, one example that was used, that was explained on the floor. There are these huge coils that come out of Tennessee. I don't try to even explain what they do. I just know they're really big and they weigh more than 60,000 pounds apiece. Okay, and in Tennessee, they're able to put two of these on a load and transport across Tennessee, and then they get to the Kentucky state line. Well, these coils weigh too much to be coming to Kentucky right now. So they have to take one of the coils off, have two trucks waiting in Kentucky to load these coils on, bring them through Kentucky, and take them to where they need to be in our state to create business. What this bill will do is provide the opportunity for that uniform process of bringing these coils into Kentucky so we can get along with the business that we need to be getting along with. So I think it's a good bill. Also, let's remember that technology grows everywhere, and in fact, it's grown with the method of how things are hauled. So what would have been damaging to the roads doing it a certain way 20 years ago? Well, things have changed. The technology has changed, and it's easier to haul heavier loads than it used to be. So this is a great bill, and again, there is so much going on in the aluminum industry that Kentucky is right in the middle of, that we have a fantastic opportunity to grow an industry that we haven't been able to do before. This is just one of those common sense bills that's going to help that happen.
Thank you, Joe. It's passed the House. Now it's in your court. What's the likelihood it passes the Senate and goes to the governor?
Well, I know that the chairman is going to have a hearing on it, and I will tell you that he's got some concerns. I'll just be very open and transparent with you that he's got some concerns. He's a very judicious type of chairman. He likes things vetted out thoroughly. If he feels like it hasn't been vetted thoroughly, he'll put the brakes on and slow it down a little bit. So we're going to have a hearing this week on it. It's on his agenda. Whether he allows for a vote, I don't know yet.
Okay. I'll tee this question up. All four of you feel free to weigh in. We've just kind of scratched the surface. We know there's going to be a special session later this summer or fall related to either tax reform and or pension reform. Any idea when that special session may be called?
Well, they asked my opinion, and I gave it to them, but I don't know whether they'll yield to it or not. But I would assume that it will probably be in early fall, would be my hunch. It would be September, but I don't know that for a fact. I don't know if they know that.
Sure. Same.
We haven't heard, for sure.
Okay. Fair enough. Joe, I'm going to tee this up to you. Please explain, summarize Senate Bill 11, which deals with nuclear power.
Yeah, that bill just passed yesterday or day before. So what it allows, what this bill is about, heretofore, we have one nuclear power plant down in Western Kentucky, and heretofore, you had to have, in order to have a nuclear power plant, you had to have a disposable plan in place for the byproduct, the waste product. What this bill allows for is for a storage plan in place. Nuclear is a big source of our national energy portfolio. I think we produce something like 20 to 25% of our power across the country is nuclear. Harvey, is that right? I'll yield to you.
I think it's less than that.
I might challenge you on that. I think it's 20%, at least 20%. We can look at, but it's an important part of our portfolio, our energy portfolio. And this just highlights the need, the perceived need of looking at this as a alternative to power. So that's the long and the short of it. The bill simply provided for a different plan for the waste product.
Thanks, Joe. For our audience's benefit, I want to say there's only seven, and correct me if I'm wrong, seven working days left until the session adjourns. Can you give us kind of like a timeline of, because I don't think you technically, there's a break, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the last day is scheduled to be maybe March 30th or 31st. But can
30th.
For the audience, can you kind of walk us through both Senate and House, what the remaining schedule looks like, and what you'll be doing between now and then, and what committees will be focusing on? I'm assuming in the Senate you'll be looking at House bills that have passed and vice versa. But for our audience, can you kind of give a recap of the whole process?
Well, I'm really surprised that no one's asked about Real ID, Senate Bill 1, education reform, and our judicial reform. Because to me, these are really the highlights of this session, particularly this judicial reform that we just went through. This is a huge deal for the state of Kentucky. What we're taking incarcerated individuals and giving them a tool to be productive members of society. This was transformational. We're giving them opportunities. We're giving them a tool to come back out into society and be a productive member of society. And no one's asked that question, and that's probably been one of the biggest issues that we've addressed during the session. So, you know, hopefully that'll make it. But here's the thing.
We agree.
Yeah.
That's why we're not talking.
All right.
We agree. Why would we ask? We know it's good.
Well, because it's got to be signed into law.
But we agree.
So, yeah. But there's okay. No problem.
We don't disagree.
All right. So let me say this. Here's the way it's going to work. We got 7 days left. If you have a bill that's clean, it's not going to have any amendments, like we get bills over from the House right now. If we add no amendments to that, the odds of that bill passing are good. But if a bill comes over to the House and we put amendments on it and it goes back to the House and they have to concur, it's probably not going to make it. It's probably not going to make it. That's why I pulled my Senate Bill 226, which was separating CERS from KRS, off the docket, because there's so much traffic up there legislatively right now. I was afraid it'd get run over and wouldn't make it through the process. So you have to be very careful. That's the way it's going to be. If a bill's clean, it'll probably has a pretty good chance of making it, but if it's going to be amended, there's not time.
You need us to call and say we agree.
Yeah.
Or disagree.
Well, yeah, sure, absolutely.
Always.
Make your voice heard.
Yeah.
What's wrong with the IDs then, since you brought that up?
I'll have to defer to my members in the House. That's where it's at currently.
Well, the real ID, there was a lot of controversy back earlier whether, during last session, whether, how much information you give to the federal government, where that information's going to be housed, all of those items. And Susan Tierney's here, so she'll know that I was hot on the phone with her to make sure that we were where we needed to be. This is where it came to this time, where it passed out of the House. You have an option to get your driver's license the way you've always gotten your driver's license and not have anything else specifically in that manner. The real ID is very specific for if you want to get on a plane and travel. The FAA is going to require you to have some type of additional, you know, identification outside of what you normally have as your driver's license, your Kentucky driver's license. And so as far as scanning the information in, things like that, I think we have a really misconception on what information the government has, what they don't have, what we want to give them, what we don't want to give them. And the government already has quite a bit of the information. So as far as you going and applying for a real ID, you're really going to have the same information you would normally have to apply for a driver's license. Where we've run into the state of Kentucky, where it been, because we had, actually we had, the it was passed both houses last year. I didn't vote for it last year in the form that it was. When it came back this year, I have voted for it. It gave the option. If you want your regular driver's license the way you always have, you can have that option. If you want the real ID that's a federal recognized, you know, where you can get on a plane with that ID and that verifies you to be able to fly, it verifies you to be able to get on a military base, because all of our, at Fort Campbell and Fort Knox, we were really going to put people in the state of Kentucky at a disadvantage. If you go onto that site, you know, if you're a repairman that's an approved person to go onto that site, if you don't have a real ID, you're not going to be able to enter the military bases in the state of Kentucky without that ID.
Is the military ID okay?
The military ID is going to be consistent with what the real ID would be. I mean,
so
it's
military ID
would qualify because it is a federal document.
Okay. Passport.
And so a passport, you could use a passport to get on a plane. But you've got to realize, a passport is a federal ID. So, I mean, that's the choice. So as far, there's been a lot of, you know, there's been a lot of chitter chatter about it. And last time we had a lot, we had some large groups, especially out of Northern Kentucky, that was like, we don't want the federal government to have our information. You know, and it was, and so, but, and I mean, it was the same difference of someone that was debating this told me that they didn't want to text anybody because they didn't want the government to see what they say, so they send me an email. So does anyone see any? So anyway, that's where we were on that. But now that it came back and people have that option, if they do not want the federal ID, you know, the real ID card, if they do not want that. But we did have some concerns, and the clerk will tell you, we had some major concerns initially, the way it was before, and until it got to the options, and to make sure, I'll tell you another thing that we look at. Whenever they start asking us if we're going to take money away from our local clerk, you know, as far as the processing fees and things like that, we kind of throw our hand up and say, you know, don't be taking money away from our local people that are doing things. And so once we kind of got through that, once the amendments were made and everything, we were really very specific, and we make the phone calls a lot of times with our locals to see if they're going to be okay with it, if this is going to work, or if this is going to mess up their world. I mean, those are the questions we a lot of times ask. So it has left the House. It is headed to the Senate. I don't know as far as, but if we do not pass this in the state of Kentucky, Kentucky will be out of compliance as far as the federal regulations.
Yep, you did. Go ahead.
I just want to clarify one thing that you said, just so this group doesn't misunderstand. If it passes, and I'm Susan Tierney, I'm You won't have to give me the documentation like your birth certificate, your social security card, and proof of residence. You won't have to give me that because you've already given me that. But you won't get your license like you used to. But I won't hand you across the driver's license that day.
You'll get a temporary.
It will also be mailed to you.
Okay. Yeah.
I won't be issuing anything. I just wanted that.
She's right, and I apologize. As far as the way you normally get it, you walk in and hand it to you. You would get a temporary real ID at the time, and then it would come in the mail to you later. So, I mean, it's... Thanks for clarifying that, because I did know that, but yes.
So if that's done on voting day, the temporary is going to work as an ID?
Yes.
Or just the regular driver's license, or are we talking about gold real ID for everything?
I'm just going to make a few remarks, and that way they can go through a few more questions, though. But there's 780-something bills filed this session, and I remember the speaker saying there's 540 in the House alone, and it's the busiest short session that we've had. So you all can imagine, I know you all have a lot of questions and things like that. To become an expert on 540 of them in 30 days isn't possible. So each one of us have kind of done our duty on getting on board with certain ones that are clean and that are most likely to pass the House and the Senate, as Joe said. So, you know, we've been hearing House bills. You know, we've heard a few Senate bills, but I'd say next week we're probably going to start hearing a whole lot of Senate bills and trying to get some of that stuff done. So,
thanks,
Matt. CJ? I just personal observation of the process we've been up there. They said it was going to be like drinking from a fire hydrant. It's more like sticking your tongue in Niagara Falls. 700 bills, and we really do sort of rely on each other to get us the big picture on the bills that are coming up. And then as they get closer, like the ones that are coming from the Senate, I haven't looked at a lot of Senate bills yet because we've been dealing what we're doing with in the House. And personally, I've got 5 bills over in the Senate committees that I'm trying to usher through the process.
You're part of the problem.
Yes, I am. But every one of them are very important, so I'm going to count on Senator Bowen to come through for me. But there is a lot to process. And so if you do have specific questions and we don't answer, you know, if we're not sure, we can give you a perfect answer. For me personally, let me know when we finish. If I need to do some research, I'll be glad to do some research. I'll come back with you, and we can talk about it in more detail.
Thank you. And with that, I want to thank the chamber for organizing today. I want to thank our senator and representatives for being here today. I want to thank all of you for taking time out of your Saturday morning to be here with us. So I hope you have a great rest of this beautiful Saturday weekend. Thank you.
Good.